pratite emisiju 15 minuta. Od 2001. godine američka vlada kroz različite investicije, programe, projekte u Srbiju je uložila 1 milijardu dolara. Da li je taj novac dobro potrošen, o tome danas nećemo razgovarati. Odgovor na to pitanje više bi trebao da interesuje građane Amerike, čiji je to novac zapravo, ali između ostalog hoćemo i o tome šta je to donelo građanima Srbije, da li i kako osjećaju u svojim životima neki boljitak zbog toga što je uloženo. Moj gost danas, predstavnik jednog od najvećih američkih programa ovde u Srbiji, USAID, Bork Bierman. Don't worry, this was just for the intro. We'll continue in English.
Oh, that's fine.
It's the first time you're not only in Niš, but it's your first time in Serbia.
No, this is my second time.
Second time in Serbia.
Yes.
Okay. If you keep coming, you'll understand. You can understand some Serbian words.
I hope so. It's been 17 years since my last visit. So I've had quite a bit of time that's passed. But it's great to be back in the area. This is the actually last of the countries that I've visited during this trip over the last 2 weeks. I started in Albania and went to Bosnia Herzegovina, and now I'm here in Serbia. And it's been a great experience to talk to the implementing partners, talk to our stakeholders, talk to government officials, talk to my staff, talk about the things that we're accomplishing and the things that we need to accomplish.
Yeah, you can say that we speak, it depends who you ask, we speak the same or the similar language in all those countries. But Serbian can give you headache if they say that it's quite hard because of the grammar.
Yeah. But what's really interesting for me is 17 years, the changes that have occurred over the course of the last 17 years are really quite amazing. And I think the perspective of having that period of time in between visits gives you a different perspective than someone who has to, you know, be here every single day and doesn't really see the change because they're experiencing it over that period of time. But I think this particular region has come a long way.
You're in charge for a quite big region. Mm-hmm. It's Europe.
Yes.
Eurasia.
Yes. So we cover the Caucasus, Georgia, Azerbaijan, and Armenia. And then we cover also Moldova, Ukraine, Belarus, and of course the Balkans.
From people coming from America, from USA, sometimes it's hard to understand the region. What helped you understanding the region and the issues here?
Well, first off, talking to people, talking to our stakeholders on the ground, whether they're in our democracy and governance programs, or they're working with our economic development programs, or they're talking within our energy programs, which is why I'm here today to sign an MOU with three municipalities on energy efficiency. I'm looking forward to talking about that. But we talking to people about the programs over the course of not just the last few years, but over the last 19 years, we've done a tremendous amount of work.
And in your organization, you were the one in charge for making priorities for this region. What are those priorities?
Well,
and is Serbia anyhow different from the countries, other countries you're covering?
Every country is different. But then there are the same issues that we're dealing with in every single country. So we're dealing with democracy and governance in every single country. We're dealing with fighting corruption. We're dealing with rule of law issues. We're dealing with independent media. We're dealing with energy and energy efficiency. We're dealing with economic development. We're dealing with a number of different issues. But at the same time, we're also dealing with a number of the same issues.
The part you didn't understand when I was talking to in Serbian, I was talking about the money. Mm-hmm. USA invested here in Serbia $1 billion from 2001. I won't ask you, is that money well spent? It's a question, the answer that should interest citizens of America. It's their money. But if you can explain how did it affect to the citizens of Serbia in their lives?
Oh, absolutely. I think foreign development is one of the best uses of the American tax dollar because the development of a partner What we're doing here in Serbia, what we're doing in the Balkans, what we're doing in the entire Bureau is we're building partnerships, we're building friendships, we're building allies, we're building those people who are not only going to help us create a better world, but also trade and economic development. We're developing people who are going to stand with us when other countries are in need. So I can tell you firsthand, specifically since this is my second tour at USAID, I spent, as you probably know, 2002 to 2007 working at USAID, and now again, of course, as the assistant administrator over the last year and a half, helping countries on the journey to self-reliance, as our administrator has said, is such a critical part of developing partners, developing countries that are working alongside us on issues that are important to all of us.
Can it be watched separately? Things you were talking about, the media, you were doing with institutions, mm-hmm. with non-governmental organization. Can we watch them separately, or it's important to improve in every specific
No, I think it's important that we work with all of the sectors. Specifically last night, I was talking to a group of civil society leaders, and I was extraordinarily impressed with the work that they were doing. In fact, I'm wearing this button, as you can see.
Yeah, we can.
And we can talk about that particular program where we choose our representatives. But I think that the work that they're doing to get people involved in their communities is incredibly important. I think part of a vibrant democracy is when every single person is involved in the process. And so I was hearing about a specific program that they were working on the local airport. I don't know, you're probably familiar with their effort. And you know, what's interesting about that effort is that they brought a tremendous amount of people together to try to keep the control of that airport here locally rather than on a national level. And although they weren't ultimately successful, what they were successful at was bringing people together from, one, the community, two, from opposite sides that agreed on issues, and three, just engaging the community. And it's important to be successful, but I think it's also important to be involved. And I think what I take away from that particular effort is that now people are engaged and they understand the importance, right, of their contributions. And so that's critically important.
What do you think about that program? People have a problem here in Serbia to understand how important it is to have in the government people they voted. It's now left to the parties, right, to choose the representatives.
Well, I think it's critically important to have representation from a particular area and represent a particular constituency. My background is actually started in local representation. Actually, to some degree, I started with a small environmental organization that I started, and we were trying to clean up a state park. And then ultimately, I got involved with running for office. But what was important to me was representation of that particular constituency, having that constituency understand that I was here to represent their specific issues, having them understand that when I went to the House of Representatives, which is our local form of government in the state of Rhode Island, that I was representing their wishes, that I wasn't representing necessarily a party, that I wasn't representing a special interest, that I was representing the issues that were important to that local community. And so that's why local representation is so important. People need to know that their participation as a voter and their representative is actually helping them accomplish the goals at a very local level.
We're dealing here with lack of ethics in many areas. Politics is one of them. How would you say how important it is for politicians to recognize that they're not representing the parties, but the people who elected them? That's a part of that program you're wearing.
I think politicians need to understand what they're representing in terms of the local constituency, in terms of helping the country move ahead, that when they actually get elected, it's about governing. It's about working together to accomplish goals. And there's never been a more important time, in my estimation, that our politicians, if you will, not just here in Serbia, but around the world, need to come together to accomplish things that will help a society, a community move ahead. And so And I also think transparency is incredibly important. We were talking about that earlier before the show. We were talking about how transparency is incredibly important, how independent media is incredibly important.
Do you recognize that problem in other countries, or is specific for Serbia about how
the
politicians recognize the interest of the people they are representing?
I think so. I've seen both a caring, if you will, for people at the local level, but I've also seen a political at the more national level that's more interested in retaining power than they are in serving the people. And I think that's important for us to recognize that we're all here to serve. And it's important people recognize that when they get elected, they have a responsibility. They have a responsibility to people. They have a responsibility to find common ground. Our politicians sometimes are so set in stone, set so line in the sand, that they really take up more time bickering and arguing about issues that don't go anywhere than they do representing people.
We're here to serve also. So your second time in Serbia, mm-hmm. you have a chance to meet with tabloids here?
Yes. I've had a chance, as I mentioned earlier, this is the third country that I visited in the Balkans. And let me just say for those who are looking, watching, I have seen incredible change in the 17 years. As I mentioned earlier, I think it's interesting to have a perspective like I do, having not been here in such a long period of time. I can see where it could be frustrating. But here's the thing, right? What I have noticed is the hope and optimism when I talk to people, especially young people. That's not to say that there aren't issues, that there aren't challenges, that there isn't corruption at the local level, at the state level, at the federal level. But what I see is hope and optimism in the Balkans and specifically in the countries that I've visited.
Yes, the truth is in numbers, a great number of young people is leaving Serbia. But let's get back to media issue. My advice to you is don't buy or read tabloids here, because they're not in Serbia. Tabloids are not tabloids in usual, usual meaning. Everywhere else, you won't find anything about movie stars, any stars at all. Not fun at all. It's all about politics. Yeah. It's all about dealing with political opponents, some public figures, and things like that. It's filled with hate speech. Mm. You said you have a great experience in politics, in business, but you are also an educated journalist.
I was, yes. Or I am.
So I would like to hear your opinion, how dangerous that is, and what can things like that, things being published, we all know that people like buying tabloids, what can that do to a society?
It's very dangerous. I think when we develop constituency-oriented media, which is basically, as I see it, a particular media catering to an audience, it's no longer actually information. It's more, as in a way, directing the particular constituency in an area that they're interested in, right? They're not interested in delivering the news. I think it's important to have fair, free, and independent media.
And that professional media.
Absolutely. And I can say that the media has changed in the past 33 years since I graduated with my journalism degree from Bowling Green State University. But what's I think is remarkable and sad in many ways is this constituency-focused journalism, politically oriented journalism, that has gotten away from the independence and the fair and free and helping people understand news rather than directing them.
We're getting back to ethics we talked about when we talked about politicians. One issue here is unprofessional journalism. Mm-hmm. I mean, tabloids we talked about. The other thing is the freedom of press. USAID have some programs considering press. How can that help improve the situation here, which is not
Look, I think, in my opinion, it's the fourth pillar of government, right? It allows independent media will create transparency. It will hold our government officials accountable. It will give people confidence that their institutions that they're supporting with their tax dollars are being spent correctly. It will give people the understanding of how government works. And it will then also hold government officials accountable when they're corrupt. And so it's important to have a fair and free, as I mentioned earlier, an independent media that's actually helping hold the government accountable for the corruption and for the rule of law that's needed in any democracy.
Let's get back to USAID. When it's about USAID, the best news really would be that you're going. That would mean in any country that it came to a certain level of development, yes, that your mission is done, am I right?
No, our mission is not done. We are.
No. Any country, right. If that country came to a certain level of development, the USAID mission is done. I want to ask you, on what level is Serbia? On what point is it far or close to that point that USAID is leaving? But what you said, what should happen in any country so that you can say our mission here is done?
Well, look, I think we've seen a tremendous amount of success in my bureau. I can think about when I first joined USAID, we had a number of countries that are no longer receiving assistance, right? I look at Romania, and I look at Croatia, and I look at Hungary, and I look at Bulgaria, and I could go on to the other countries that are now part of the EU, and they are thriving countries that no longer need our help and are actually, if you will, helping us in the countries that we're still working in. We're signing MOUs with other countries to help us throughout the region, which is exciting. But I think that the, if you will, the journey to self-reliance, and that's what our administrator is calling that path to success, is something that is very, what I think has been very successful in this particular area. Do I think that we're going to solve all of the problems tomorrow? No. I think that we've done a great deal of great work over the course of the last 18 years. As you mentioned, we've spent $1 billion here. We're going to be here for some time to come. We've got some work to do. But I think we've progressed a great deal. And, you know, we work with the government, and we work with civil society, and we work with the private sector. And we've got a great team of people here who are helping in those particular sectors, helping those countries be successful. But I also would suggest to you that we've seen success, we're seeing success, and there isn't a day that doesn't go by that we're seeing a lot of great work being done. But again, we understand that there are challenges. I'm looking forward to my discussion with the Prime Minister tomorrow so we can have some discussions about local representation, so we can talk about the importance of independent media, so that we can talk about rule of law issues, and so we can talk about our partnership and how we end up eventually, right, closing our doors. Because we're in the business of being out of business, right? Development has to, if you're developing forever, you're not developing anything, right? I think if I had to sum it up, the need for foreign assistance, right, is the need to end foreign assistance. And I come to work every single day trying to figure out how I can put myself out of a job. Because the day that happens is the day that we're working in partnership.
How would you say, you mentioned partnership, who is your easier partner to talk with, to work with, who is the hardest one?
That's an interesting question. I'd say that they all have differences. I know that's probably an easy answer, but I think they're all very interesting and unique in different ways, and I think it depends on the sectors, right? I won't get into the specifics, but look, I think I have enjoyed working with people. I think, in terms of the countries that we're working in, it always is great to talk to the stakeholders who like yourselves, actually, to some degree, the independent media, who are trying to help in terms of helping them integrate a much more free and open independent media. But to answer the question, and I guess I'm getting around that question, is we have challenges and successes in every country. I wouldn't put one over the other.
Yeah, we know only the things we hear after those meetings happen. You have tomorrow, you have that meeting. Would that be a hard talk? How those meetings look like?
No, I think it will be a straightforward conversation. I've met the Prime Minister on a couple of occasions. I met her in Georgia in July last year at the Open Government Partnership Program, which is a very important civil society government program, which I was really pleased to see her come. And I know she's got a digital initiative about transparency, and that's really important, so we'll probably talk a little bit about that. But we'll also talk about the importance of independent media, as I mentioned earlier. We're going to talk about the importance of rule of law, and we're going to talk about a lot of the programs that we're supporting here and how we can continue to partner, by the way, which is important, with the government to be successful, because that's important. We can't just come into an area and not create partnerships. We have to work with the government to be successful.
Yeah, we agreed that you'll be here for a while. It's a process.
It is a process.
Still, not ending, what will be the priorities? You mentioned many times the media, the institutions, transparency, and things like that. What's the one priority you would put it be the first?
Well, look, I think democracy and governance, improved governance, I think it's important to fight corruption. I think rule of law issues are critically important. You know, that's not to set one particular issue over another, but people have to have confidence in the people that are serving them. They have to have confidence in their elected officials. If you don't have confidence in your elected officials, everything else falls away. Because people aren't, private sector. Why would private sector want to invest in a country where their public servants aren't honest, where they aren't serving the people? So good governance has to be a top priority.
So you're dealing with those small businesses. Is this how would you say to an investor, is this area now safe? Should I come here? What's the situation? How do you see the situation in this region, in Serbia particularly?
I think it's important for businesses to understand what the situation is in here. But I look around, not just in Serbia, but throughout the Balkans. I think there's a huge amount of opportunity. I've talked to some young business owners. Now, again, I just arrived last night, so I haven't had a chance to interact with some of the small businesses or medium businesses. But what we're going to have those conversations. Actually, I'm going to be meeting with some entrepreneurs later today, and I'm looking forward to having that discussions and hearing directly from them. But what I'm hearing in terms of the entire region are the opportunities that exist here in the Balkans. I think there are tremendous opportunities for not just local entrepreneurs, but for international investors.
So we agreed that Serbia becoming a EU member would be the point that your mission here is done.
Oh, absolutely. You could say Western integration and eventually membership to the EU, of course.
Many different programs. One that you came for here today is very important for the citizens of Niš. Can you explain?
Energy is part of our priorities, and we work with energy in all of the countries that we're located in. And energy independence, energy efficiency, supporting a better system that allows a cost savings to the people, a cleaner environment, more energy independence is a critically important aspect of not just economic development, but democracy and governance as well. And so we're here to sign an MOU on an energy efficiency project with three municipalities of Čačak. Is that am I pronouncing that correctly?
Chachuk.
Of course, here in Niš, and also Pančevo. I'm probably going to mess
you
this up.
You want me to read it?
Pančevo. Yes. I'm sorry. Yeah, Pančevo. So Pančevo, Čačak, and Niš here. We're going to sign with three mayors later today. We're excited about that program. It's going to allow for efficiency. It's going to allow for energy savings and a cleaner environment.
It's really important for the citizens of Niš. Thank you for being my guest here today. I hope we'll see you again. Thanks for being a guest here at Južne Vesti, at South News.
It's been a pleasure to be here. I'm looking forward to coming back at some point. I hope you'll have me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Vama hvala što ste pratili emisiju 15 minuta.